Everyone. All right, great. Great to see you all. And welcome to our meeting this week. And good morning if you're joining us online. I hope you're all doing well. Welcome to the meeting. And in a moment, we'll get into a time of singing. And then we'll just get to share some family news. And then, very exciting, we are kicking off a new sermon series called History Maker. And that's just seeing how the gospel broke into Europe and has changed and shaped the history of the world for the last 2,000 years. So I'm very excited about that sermon series. But for what is currently shaping our world today, I think many of us, I can see people on their phones. I'm hoping they're not refreshing what's happening at the IEBC or what's happening on this newspaper or that newspaper. But I'd say many of us have been anxious, if not most of us, of what's been happening with the election results. I mean, I was up this morning just to check what's the difference between the tally from last night to the tally this morning. And it will be great for us, just as we start, to remind ourselves of where God is in this situation and in our lives. And as we start our meeting, I'd just love to read from us, for us from Psalms 46. And this is the way it starts. It says, God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth gives way, though the mountains be moved into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains tremble at its swelling. And for some of us, election results can sometimes feel like the mountains are shaking. They're going into the heart of the sea. It says, there is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy habitation of the Most High. God is in the midst of her. She shall not be moved. God will help her when morning dawns. And this just speaks of the presence of God's Spirit among His people. That though election results will come and go, God's Spirit remains with His people. The nation rage, the kingdoms totter. He utters His voice, the earth melts. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. And this is our hope this morning. As we gather, we want to lift our eyes from what's happening around us to God who is with us, God who is our refuge and our strength. Whether you are Azimio La Umoja, whether you are Kenya Kwanzaa, our ultimate refuge and strength is God. Come behold the works of the Lord, how He has brought desolations on the earth. He makes wars cease to the end of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear. He burns the chariots with fire. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Why don't we stand together as we stand on these great truths that God is in our midst. God is our refuge and our fortress. It is God that we look to, not anything that is happening in our world. And so as we gather, I'll just invite you as well to continue to be open to some encouragement that God might lay on your heart. If you feel God has laid something, a scripture or a picture or anything else, just come and speak to me in the front and we'll give you an opportunity to share, because that's why we've gathered together this morning, to build each other up, to look to our God who's our refuge and our strength. Let's pray and we'll hand over to the band. Lord, we look to You, our refuge and our strength. We trust in Your promise to be among us this morning. You are the river that makes glad the people of God. We are going to be still and we're going to know that You are God this morning. Amen.
Utukufu wako, uwezo wako, ufalme wako, ni wa milele. Tingiki kamwe.
You're the rock.
You're the rock on which I stand. You're the one that never changes. In Your arms I
You're protecting me. Through your power I am mighty. Against the weapons formed against me, I shall not fear. I shall not fear. Nimogope na ni na ye mungu akona mi. Nimogope na ni na ye mungu akona mi. Utukufu wako, uwezo wako, ufalme wako, ni wa milele. Nguvu zako, wema wako, fadhili zako, hazitingiki kamwe. You're protecting me. Through your power I am mighty. Against the weapons formed against me, I shall not fear. I shall not fear. I shall not fear. You will go pain on me. Gope na ni na ye mungu akona mi, 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 akona mi.
Yes, Lord, we invite you here this morning. We fix our eyes on you. We are so grateful that you are in our midst. Because of you, we don't fear. May you be glorified this morning. I want to invite the kids. Talia is going to help us with one of our songs this morning. I want to help invite the kids to come and help us adults to worship with all of our bodies.
Ooh. can't help but feel a little down, a little worried when I look around. That's why my hope is in, my hope is in the Lord. I fix my eyes upon the one who gives, 'cause all I need is what I have in him. That's why my hope is in, my hope is in the Lord. Hope is in the Lord. I belong to Him. He will never let me go. My hope is in the Lord. I can count on Him. My hope is in the Lord. My hope is in the Lord. I belong to Him. He will never let me go. My hope is in the Lord. I can count on Him. My hope is in the Lord. Ooh, 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 ooh.
Yeah, we can clap together. Thank you, children. Yeah, and so we want to release our children this morning to go to their class. And if your child is between 2 and 10, make sure you pick them up afterwards. There's a card that you received. Make sure you take it to the class as you pick them up. So just want to pray for our children as they go. Father, we thank you this morning as our children go to their class. We thank you for your word, for your promises upon their lives. The Bible says our children shall be taught of the Lord, and great shall be their peace. And we pray this morning that you shall keep on increasing that peace as they are taught of you, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for the families represented here. Keep on showing yourself strong on our behalf. Keep on helping us to shepherd them and guide them and govern them in the ways of the Lord, that great shall be their peace. Let your peace be upon our children. May you go with them to the future and show yourself strong, even when we shall not be present and active in their lives, because you delight in them. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Children, you're free to go.
Yeah, just as the kids are leaving, I just wanted to share something that's been on my heart the last couple of weeks. I think just reading the news and things in our personal lives also, sometimes I just feel this groaning in my heart, like, Jesus, come back. We are so ready for you to come back. And I was reminded of this old song that we're going to sing just now. Just this realization that He's already come. Like, yes, He's coming back to make everything right, but He's already come. And because of that, we can have hope. Because of that, we don't need to fear. Because of that, we can say, Hosanna. We can be free to live our lives anchored to Him with our eyes fixed on Him. And it's just been such an encouragement for me to keep on reminding myself that even as we groan, and Scripture talks about that groaning for Him to come back to make everything right, He's already come. And so we can just praise Him today with an abandon and say, thank you, Lord, that you've come to give us that hope.
See the King of Glory coming on the clouds with fire. The whole earth shakes, the whole earth shakes. I see His love and mercy washing over all our sin. The people sing, people sing, Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest.
a generation rising up to take their place with selfless grace, selfless grace. I see a near revival stirring as we pray and sing. We're on our knees, we're on our knees. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Heal my heart and make it clean. Open up my eyes to the things unseen. Show me how to love like you and love me. Break my heart for what breaks yours. And everything I am for your kingdom's cause. As I walk from earth into eternity.
Heal my heart.
Heal my heart and make it clean.
Let's sing it out. Let that be our prayer.
Open up my eyes to the things unseen. Show me how to love like you have loved me. Break my heart for what breaks yours. Everything I have for your kingdom's cause. As I walk from here into eternity. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna.
Worship you. You are here
you, I worship you. You are here, turning lives around. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, mending every heart. I worship you, I worship you. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keep, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. That is who you are. That is who you are.
Declare it.
That is who you are. 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 That is who you are.
Even when
I don't feel it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. Never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. Never stop working. Never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. Never stop working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. Never stop working. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you
As we were singing the song, I was reminded of a story in the Bible about a man called Lazarus who had died, and his family had already done the whole burial thing for him. And Jesus came, and he said he asked them to open where Lazarus was, and he called Lazarus forth, and Lazarus rose, and Lazarus was still wrapped. He was awake, but he was still wrapped in his garments. That's what the Bible says. And even as we're singing and as I was praying with the worship team earlier, I just really had a sense that there's some people who might be already alive in Christ. They've woken up, but they're still wrapped in those death clots. And I feel like these are sometimes represented through the lies of the enemy, through things about ourselves, thoughts and beliefs that we have about ourselves that are still with the dead nature. And I really feel God wants to release some people from some of those death cloths that you're still wrapped in. it might be like beliefs or just, yeah, that you're alive, but you're still living as if you're still dead. Yeah.
You know, this new life in Christ, it's not a theory. It's not a concept. It's not religious activities that we do. But it's true power. True power that changes lives. True power that breaks addictions. True power that gives peace in turmoil. True power that brings mental health where there's been confusion or fear and anxiety. It is true power that causes us to see ourselves really as God sees us. And that's what Michelle was just talking about as she says, God is inviting us to be unwrapped from the old clothes and to put on the new. And I just want to give us a moment just for you to reflect on that word. Just if there's any area of your life where you haven't quite released the old life or you felt gripped by the old life, and just to invite God's power to work in that and give you newness of life, give you health in your mind, give you health in your habits. And then we'll just continue with the next song. So we'll just continue playing, but just take moments, reflect and pray over yourself in that way.
Promise keep a light in the darkness, my God.
That is who you are. Let's declare that again. He is Waymaker.
Waymaker, miracle work, promise keep, light in the darkness, my God. That is who you are. You give me life. Waymaker, miracle work, promise keep, light in the darkness, my God. That is who you are. Yes, that is who you are. 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 Light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are Waymaker, miracle work, promise keeper. In the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
Yeah, Father, just as we are thinking about this new life that you have given us, those cloths that wrap us that we need to get rid of. Father, thank you that you are the one who makes a way for us. You are the one who works miracles in our lives. You are the one who keeps promises. Yeah, Father, and we do just want to say this morning that it's in you alone that we can live and breathe. It's in you alone that we can have hope, that we can find strength. It's in you alone that we can be free, that we can live in peace and joy.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, the solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving ceases. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save, till on that cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. Darkness slain, and bursting forth a glorious day. Up from the grave he rose again, and as we stand in victory, since curse and lost his grip on me, for I am his, he is mine, bought with the precious blood of No guilt in life, no fear in death. This is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me
from his hand till he returns and calls me home. This is the power of Christ. I'll stand.
No power,
no power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I'll stand. Here in the power of Christ I stand.
I'll just invite Peps up to come and pray for us as we close our time of worship.
And Father, we come to you this morning, you alone, on Christ alone. I'm just remembering this time that the disciples were gathering in John 6, 66 and 7. And then things were hard for them. The teachings were hard when Jesus is saying, eat my flesh, drink my blood. The Bible says many of them started leaving. And Jesus turned to his disciples and he asked them, do you also want to leave? Peter said, where else can we go? You have the words of life. And this morning, where else can we go? You have the words of life. We come to you in our brokenness, in our confusion. We come to you this morning, where else can we go? You have the words of life. For some of us going through a hard time this morning, we still chose to come to you because you have the words of life. Let your life be infused in us. May you be the lifter of our heads. May you lift our heads this morning, oh God. Some of us who are going through difficult situations, we don't know how we'll make it through. Where else can we go? You have the words of life. Infuse your life in us this morning, Lord, and cause us to come alive in you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Why don't we take our seats and also just give the band a hand. And just as they're taking their seats, I'd like to invite Kyle, who was drumming and on his way out, just to join me on the stage. Yeah. Kyle is on his way to school in the US, so he's just finishing up his high school and preparing for college. And he recently got his visa to be able to go to the States. And we just wanted to pray for Kyle. He's been in this church longer than I have been. And as you saw, he was drumming and really serving throughout the time. And so we're really going to miss Kyle and all that he's been as a part of the church, an incredible example of serving as a young man, a teen, and being in the band. And we just want to commit him to God. It's not easy going to be away from family. His dad currently works for the UN and is in the DRC, and his mom is here and his siblings. So it's not going to be easy. But we trust that there will be a big family waiting for him in the States, part of God's worldwide family. But more than that, just as we've been singing this morning, that it is Christ who is with us, and it is Christ who strengthens us. So please, would you just stretch out your hands? And if you know Kyle, you can also just come and join me and just lay hands on him, and I'll just pray for him. Yeah, Father, we want to thank you for Kyle. We thank you for just getting this time with him to be part of this community and to input into his life and also see him serve and grow and just for their whole family. Lord, we just think of young men that you have called in Scripture, from your disciples to Joseph and David, and we just want to pray that Kyle would be a man after your own heart, that more than anything else, he would walk closely with you, and he would know your voice. He would know your grace. He would be a young man who trusts in you with all of his heart, who lives in the love that you give, who says, who else can I turn to? You alone have the words of life. And Lord, as we send him to school, we ask that you would go before him. We ask that he would find a great community within that school and beyond that in a church, people that he can fellowship with, where he can continue to grow and exercise his gifts and continue to get to know you better. We pray for friends who would walk with him and who would encourage him in the things of God. We pray that his faith would grow, it would be strengthened, and that it wouldn't diminish. And Lord, we just ask that you guide his steps into the future in everything that you have in store for him. Bless him. Would you be a blessing to their family, even as they've had to take this difficult decision? But would it be something that results for the good, for their family, and for your glory? In Jesus' name, amen. 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 Why don't we give Kyle a hand? All right, great. We'll just share a few pieces of family news. And firstly, I'd love to welcome anyone who's joining us for the first time, whether here in person or you're online. Karibu tena, you're very welcome. And I'll just ask you to raise your hand at the moment so we can just acknowledge you. We won't embarrass you or make you stand up or anything like that. And so if you're here and you're with us for the first time, please could you just raise your hand. There are a couple of hands waving at the back. Welcome, guys. If you haven't received a card or like this slip of paper, please just keep your hands raised. And that's just for us to share a bit about who we are and also for you to share a bit about who you are so that we can get to know you better and also get in touch with you during the week. Please could we get a card from any of the ushers? There's still a couple of hands raised. All right, great. Thank you. And if you're online, you can just put a comment or just, let us know how we can get in touch with you, as we'd love to get to know you well as well. And speaking about getting to know one another better and well, I'd just love to let all those newcomers, or if you're visiting or if you visited us on the past few weeks, that we'll have a newcomers lunch on the 28th of August, and you can sign up for that online. There'll be a link where you can just click and sign up for that. And why we ask people to sign up is just so that we can know how many people we're catering for. And this is an opportunity for you just to meet people within the church and some of the leaders and just share what your first impressions have been of joining with us, so that we can keep our gatherings relevant for people who are joining us and who are new to our community. So please do sign up for newcomers luncheon. The final announcement that I'm going to share before I invite James to share a couple is just for us, we're getting into a time of giving. And I know giving is a very, delicate situation. I remember Bob, who heads our media and does all the social media and is up there, he was just sharing with me some of the TikTok videos he's put online. And some of the people were responding, and one lady asked, what is your church's doctrine on tithing? And I thought, man, that's like a hot potato. That's walking on hot coals. Because you have all sorts of things that are being said in churches, both in Nairobi and even around the world, which is, okay, give so that you can have your problem solved, or give so that you can get something into your life, or give, or God will not bless you. But actually what the Bible teaches us is that the earth is the Lord's and all the fullness. We don't give because we're trying to twist God's arm so that he can give something to us. In fact, everything that we have, even the very next breath that I'm taking, belongs to God. And so we give in acknowledgement of what God has given to us. Not that he needs it, but because we know the practical needs of what he has called us to. Not only do we give to give back what he has given to us, But we also give because we're saying we are part of the mission God has called One Tribe to. And as a church, we've said that our mission is to multiply gospel-centered, spirit-empowered missional churches in Nairobi and beyond. And I'm part of that heart and soul. And I invite all of us, if you're a member of this church, to be part of that heart and soul. And part of that is giving financially into that mission. Now, if you're joining us for the first time or you're not yet sure you want to be a member in the community, feel under no compulsion to give. We want you to give in response to what God has done for you. And I can assure you that God will continue to give breath to your lungs, to continue to provide for your food. And you don't give to twist his arm to provide good things to you, but because he has already. And with that, I just want to invite James to share two more announcements, and then we'll hand over to Cody.
Yeah, thank you, Cephas. Yeah, and it's a beautiful morning to talk about baptism. We have one coming up. Yeah, I know it will be warmer then. Yeah, so we are having a baptism class on 28th. That is which Sunday? 28th, the next or two Sundays from now. It will happen in the morning, 9 a.m. at One Tribe offices there. But more details will be shared as we move on. But if you are here, you feel you want to be baptized and or you have questions about baptism, please approach Cephas or one of the elders. Yeah, and we have men barbecue or nyama choma. I think, some few men have identified with the word nyama choma. Yeah, it's happening on the 27th, that is the next Saturday but one, and it will be in Kahawasu Kari. Yeah, so we'll share more about the location, and every One Tribe man, our men friend, let's invite as many men as we can towards this nyama choma. And we will be signing up both for baptism and nyama choma on our church website. So after this, all men, I want to see all men from One Tribe signing up for the nyama choma. Yay. Yeah, so we will be having a contribution of only 500 shillings for One Tribe men. But if you are new in One Tribe, you are not obligated to. We will pay for you. Yeah, that's it from me. Now I'll invite Cody to come and give us the word for today.
Good morning, One Tribe.
Yeah, Karibu Cody. Maybe I can pray even as he starts. Our Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, we are so grateful this morning for gathering us together, for the gift of life, the gift of your Holy Spirit, Lord. And I pray, I acknowledge the presence of the Holy Spirit from in this place, our Father. May you speak to us, counsel us, encourage us, teach us, and yeah, we are here to be taught of you, our Lord Jesus. We bless Cody, we bless his family, even as he is being used of you. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Morning, One Tribe. My name is Cody, and my wife Megan and I lead a life group here in the Runda area on Thursday nights. I guess none of my life group showed up today, but there's also another life group in Runda headed by the Cones, and if you are in the Runda or Garden Estate, our Four Ways, any of those areas near Runda, and you're looking for a place and family. See, we believe that life group is a family. We come to church, we hear the word, but then we go to our life group and live life together and share each other's burdens. So I really highly encourage you to get involved in a life group. If it's in Runda, come talk to me or the Cones. If you live in another part of the city, please see Paps and the elders, and they will direct you to the right life group. So I know everyone has been wondering what happened to Paul on his last missionary journey. Whenever we went through the Jerusalem Council and the dispute that he had with Barnabas over John Mark, well, you're in luck because today we start a new series titled History Maker. The book of Acts may be seen by some as just this history of the church, but I believe there's so much more there to learn from the narratives than just history. And God is trying to teach us something, mainly that the Spirit continues in this world today. The way that people were moved upon by the power of the Holy Spirit in the first century is the same way, the exact same way that the Holy Spirit moves upon people in Nairobi in 2022. In fact, our elders believe so much in this missional, Spirit-empowered church that even the mission statement of One Tribe reflects that calling. Multiplying gospel-centered, Spirit-empowered missional churches in Nairobi and beyond. Over the next 2 months, we'll go on a journey with Paul the Apostle and his companions as they plant churches, cast out demons, get thrown into prison, cause chaos within the religious elite, and so much more. This trip is often referred to as Paul's second missionary journey. And it's on this trip where Paul plants churches in Philippi, Thessalonica, Berea, Athens, Corinth, just to name a few. And today we'll be looking at where this journey began, which will hopefully give us some insight as to how we are supposed to live our lives in ministry today. Whenever I was a teenager, I traveled 3 times to Romania with my youth group on my first mission trip. Now, I don't know if that's saying a lot about me or a lot about my mom to trust me with the youth leader to go halfway across the world. But that experience was so impactful in my life that I knew that God had called me to be a missionary. And as I grew older, I ran from that calling. It didn't seem like the way of success. But even so, whenever I didn't want to serve God, it was like in the back of my mind, I knew that I was called to be a missionary. And that's what God had created me for. Fast forward 10 years, I was now married and had a career in banking with a master's degree in business administration. I was set for success in what the world calls success. We're in Nairobi, right? The hustler nation. We know what that type of success is. It's the clothes that you wear, the money in your bank account, your position at work, and the degree that's on your wall. What I would later learn is that success in God's economy equals something different. To God, success equals obedience. Let me say that again. Success in God's economy is being obedient to His Holy Spirit, guiding and directing. And I remember that day when Megan and I resigned our jobs to go into full-time ministry. We were excited, but we didn't know the next steps in the plan. And at that time, I only knew that God had called me into full-time ministry. I believe we've all been in that place of waiting, not knowing the next steps. Whether it's about God's direction in a job, are you supposed to stay? Are you supposed to apply somewhere else? Whether it's waiting on election results. Who's going to win? Is it Azimio or UDA? What? Which way is this going? Maybe like us, it's waiting on God's timing to conceive a child. Megan and I are about to celebrate our 10th year as married couple, and not once have we had a positive pregnancy test. Maybe you're in a school environment or university which is toxic. It's not life-giving. You know that you have to complete your studies, but you don't really even know how you're going to survive this next term. Maybe you're just struggling to live day to day, questioning how can God even show up in your circumstance. What I love about the Word of God and about these narratives in Acts is that these people are so real. And the things and the stories that they're going through just equate so much to what I feel in 2022. And I want to show you this as we read Acts 16, starting in verse 1 through 10. It says, Paul came to Derbe and then to Lystra, where a disciple named Timothy lived, whose mother was Jewish and a believer, but whose father was a Greek. The believers in Lystra and Iconium spoke well of him. Paul wanted to take him along on this journey, so he circumcised him because of the Jews who had lived in that area. For they all knew that his father was a Greek. As they traveled from town to town, they delivered the decision reached by the apostles and elders in Jerusalem for people to obey. So the churches were strengthened in the faith and grew daily in number. Paul and his companions traveled throughout the region of Phrygia and Galatia, having been kept by the Holy Spirit from preaching the word in the province of Asia. When they came to the border of Mysia, they tried to enter Bithynia, but the Spirit of Jesus would not allow them to. So they passed by Mysia and went down to Troas. During the night, Paul had a vision of a man in Macedonia standing and begging him, "Come over here and help us." After Paul had seen the vision, we got ready at once to leave for Macedonia, concluding that God had called us to preach the gospel to them. Although Paul and his and those he was journeying with didn't know the plan of the Lord, they knew that God had led them through even those times of questioning. And in the beginning of this missionary journey, Paul starts to plan his way forward, even without complete knowledge of the circumstances ahead. Now, if you remember back to the sermon taken out of Acts 15, Paul wants to start this second missionary journey, but he and Barnabas get in a heated debate over whether John Mark should accompany them, the two to a point of separation, each going their own way. As Paul sets out in ministry, he apparently needs someone to fill that role. So he chooses Timothy here in this passage. The interesting thing about Timothy is that he is the son of a Jewish background mother and pagan father. And for whatever reason, probably because his father prevented it, Timothy was never circumcised according to the law and tradition of his mother. And this passage may seem like somewhat of a contradiction to the previous sermon about the Jerusalem Council's decision on circumcision. And even Paul himself cites in 1 Corinthians 7, was a man already circumcised when he was called? He should not be uncircumcised. Was a man uncircumcised when he was called? He should not be circumcised. Circumcision is nothing and uncircumcision is nothing. But keeping God's command is what counts. Each person should remain in the situation they were in when God called them. It may seem that Paul is somehow dishonest, but in reality, even though the rite didn't mean anything anymore for believing Christians, it was an important part of Paul planning his future ministry that would include going into synagogues. If Paul had left Timothy the way that he was, their ministry would have been affected because of it. See, Paul cared so much more about breaking down barriers so that the gospel could be transmitted more effectively. So after taking Timothy, the group of missionaries continued on their journey. By this point, I know Paul had prayed. I'm sure he had fasted. Paul had planned his journey out. He had took measures to make sure that they would be accepted in the towns and villages. He did everything that he knew to do and probably so much more. After all that preparation, Paul had in his heart to travel to a populated area in a Roman province called Asia. This would have been in what we call modern-day Turkey. Can you imagine the hype and excitement? They're about to move into this new journey with the Holy Spirit. But then something happened. And the Bible doesn't really reveal how, But it says the Holy Spirit kept Paul and his companions from preaching in Asia. So they came together. They prayed again. And they decided to set out, and we're going to go to Bithynia this time. Probably with the same hype, same anticipation. Ready to spread the gospel to new areas. But again, the Spirit of Jesus did not allow them to enter. And not knowing where to go or what to do, they kept moving forward. And they eventually came to a port town called Troas. I want you to see this on the map. See, Paul leaves Antioch with Silas here on the right, bottom right side of the screen. And they're traveling up through some of the towns that they had already been through. Troas, Derbe, Lystra. As they come to Lystra, they meet Timothy. And they continue their journey westward. But as they go through this green area, Galatia, the next area they enter right on the outskirts of the pink is called Phrygia. And Paul wants to go to Asia, that whole red, pinkish area where Ephesus, where some of the all the seven churches revealed in the book of Revelations are located. Paul's going to preach there. And so he starts to plan, and the Spirit prevents him. Say, okay, Lord, what are you doing? All right, let's go to Bithynia. We're going to turn north. And we're going to go up towards Bithynia. And the Spirit, again, prevents them. So what do? They continue on that journey. And look how those places are right next to each other. And they're on this road where they can't really go north and they can't really go south. And it wasn't that God was saying to never go, because we have a book in the Bible called Ephesians. He obviously went to Ephesus. But we know that God was telling Paul something at this moment. He was saying, not now. And in my mind, I hear these two places and think they must have been like two very different areas. But they're actually next door to each other. And they can't turn northward. They can't go southward. And they're stuck on this road to the west. Have you ever felt squeezed like that? In America, we have a saying, stuck between a rock and a hard place. You ever felt like that? You wonder if there's light at the end of your tunnel? Does God know that you are surrounded on all sides? Does he have a plan to take you through? And all the while, these men felt surrounded and opposed on every side. God was trying to get Paul and Silas and Timothy over to Troas, where they would later have this vision of a man from Macedonia calling out. And that would begin their journey into what we call Europe today. It was there that they had this vision, and we're going to continue the next few weeks. We'll be hearing more about their trip through that area of Macedonia and down into Athens and Corinth. But right now, I want you to hear this, that even though your circumstances may seem hard on all sides, and you don't know, you can't fathom how, when, or where your help will come from, God is still moving you to the place where he can use you. He is teaching you things that you need to know for the future ministry. He's giving you new perspectives on the world around you. He is saying, not yet. This is not the right time for you. But keep the faith and keep pressing forward. In the beginning of my ministry in Kenya, I felt like the Holy Spirit had placed this certain people group in my heart to pray for and to go and minister to. I was very eager to visit them. I started preparing missions there. I learned some language. I started reading apologetics books so that I could win them to the faith. Now, I know this area was very hostile to the gospel, but I didn't care because I'd risk my life for Jesus. And the interesting thing was that every time I would plan on ministry in those places, somehow I would be prevented from going and traveling. And the plans, they would just never work out. And over the last couple of years, God has allowed me to begin missions endeavors in those places, giving me new opportunities and favor in missions. But there was so much that he had to first teach me. Back then, I was ready to travel, and I would have probably done way more harm than good. And I didn't realize it, but God knew. And such is life. God puts dreams, plans, and visions in our heart. We prepare, we pray, we fast. We learn languages, we take courses, we build businesses, we get out there and we hustle. And even so, we come to the place where we feel like our plans were for nothing. Our business isn't making money. Our hopes for a child have not been fulfilled. We still live in constant pain and sickness. The one we voted for is not being elected into office. God, where are you? Are you even in this journey of mine? Do you even care about what's affecting me and my life? Now, I'm going to be fully transparent here, but I would ask that you guys pray silently for us, but it's not something that we're ready to talk about right now. Megan and I are asking God these same questions. He has put hopes and dreams for us to have a biological child. We have seen a fertility doctor for almost 2 years, trying different things. Nothing worked. We desired a miracle. We wanted a miracle. But we also knew that God can somehow use the medical doctors. And so this month, we are stepping out in faith to try a new procedure. And it's like, is God going to prevent this from happening once again? Is this even God's design for our life? And the hard thing is, I don't have the answers to those questions. And neither does Paul. Paul didn't know God's plan, but he still planned, he still prepared, and then ultimately, he still moved forward anyways. Paul could have just stopped altogether, not moving one more meter, demanding direction from God in prayer. God, I won't move until you give me the whole plan. I'm just going to sit here. Stay put. Him and his associates could have said, well, you know what, guys? Since God isn't leading us north, he's not leading us south, we don't have any direction, let's turn around, go back to Antioch, where we know we can have ministry. You ever felt like that, just calling it quits, returning back to the old way because it's easy? We have faced those questions and prayed those prayers. But through it all, we have resolved in our heart to prepare and move forward, even if we don't know God's full plan for our life and family. There are many of you here this morning. You're in circumstances and facing things in your life which you need God's direction. You felt that God has placed these desires and hopes and dreams in your spirit, but you keep hitting a wall. It's like every time you try to go in a new direction, that opportunity is just taken away from you. You have bargained with God. If you just show me, I'll trust you. You've contemplated giving up, throwing in the towel, returning to the easy way, even though you know that's not what the Spirit is saying to do. While this may be the way that you and I feel, we're only human and don't know the full scope of God's plan. And yet, I bet that if you look back, you will see many times in your journey where God showed up and sovereignly led you to the place you were supposed to be and where you are now. I want you to say this with me. Whenever my plans fail, God is still in control. Whenever my plans fail, God is still in control. Although you haven't reached where God is taking you, He is still in control and directing your steps. He is putting people in your life. He is bringing new opportunities. He's keeping you from future heartache. All the singles say amen. For us, it was a certain doctor that we felt came at a providential time in our life. For Paul, it was a vision of a man from Macedonia calling out to him. For you, it may be a new friend who's coming along at just the right time, or maybe a chance encounter that alters your future. Whatever the method may be, God is sovereignly leading you to the place where He can use you and your testimony. The Life Application Bible points out some ways that God sovereignly guided His people in the book of Acts. Through direct revelation, through scripture, through the casting of lots, through unexpected supernatural acts, through the apostles' teachings, through judgment, through church growing pains, through persecution and evil opposition, through angelic messengers, through miraculous relocation, through direct life-altering encounters with the risen Lord, through visions, through human instruments, messengers, through times of intense prayer, through bringing to our minds the word of the Lord, through prophetic utterances, through God-honoring, Spirit-led discussions among church leaders, through promptings by the Spirit, through closed doors, through favorable circumstances, through having them take advantage of civil, legal, and political rights. If the worship team could join me up front, please. This one thing is for sure. God is working behind the scenes in your life. I'll say it again. He's moving you to this place where He can use you and your testimony to encourage and strengthen others for the future. If this message resonated with you and you'd say, Cody, I felt like my situation is weighing upon me and I feel like everything that I do is for nothing. Cody, where's God in my life? I keep hearing about deliverance, but I only see destruction. My hope is gone. My faith is low. It's really hard to trust God right now. If that's something that you're feeling this morning, I want you to slip up your hand. If that's you. Can we all stand together? And the worship team is going to sing Waymaker once again. And I want us to think about that, about how it, as a profession of faith, that even in the midst of your circumstance, no matter what you're going, no matter how anxious you are about the elections or what's going on in your life, you don't know where God's taking you in your business. You don't know where God's taking you in your life. I want you to sing this song and think about God making a way in every circumstance, because that's what He did for the apostles, and that's what He does for us. He makes a way whenever we don't even know that there is a way. We plan and our plans fail and we feel like we're surrounded on all sides, like we're between a rock and a hard place. But in the end, God and Spirit is still in control. He's leading you to the place where He can use you. He's going to use your testimony. And I know that He is with you today. Let us sing this together.
You are here, moving in. worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are here, touching every heart. I worship you. Worship you. You are here, healing every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, turning lives around. I worship you. I worship. Worship you. You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. 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 Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. Never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. Never stop working. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
That is who you are.
That is who you are. That is who you are. That is who you are.
That is who you are.
That is who you are. That is who you are. That is who you are.
Hey, guys. guys, as I was thinking about this and just praying, I really felt like the Lord was saying to not focus on our circumstances. In the midst of all of those circumstances, as Cody was talking about his own personal stuff and just thinking about our own things going on in our own lives, that God wants us to focus on who he is and his character, talking about in 2 Corinthians. So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen. For what is seen is temporary and what is unseen is eternal. I've been studying about different missionary biographies and even thinking about Stephen being martyred. Like, Lord, how is that good? Even thinking about missionaries coming in to different people groups and never seeing one convert. But then generations later, they never see anything, but generations later, we hear about people coming to know Jesus because of their faithfulness till the end, because they trusted in their good shepherd. They trusted in their good father who loves them. And so I don't know what you're going through, but guys, I just want to encourage us, as the Lord is encouraging me, to focus on who God is and his character and who we are in him, not just on our circumstances.
Yep. And, you know, this morning is, I feel like, is a wonderful opportunity that God is meeting with different people in different ways. I don't know about you, but when my plans don't work out, I throw my toys out of the cot. Michelle, you're not allowed to laugh at that. But I think all of us, we respond in different ways when things don't go the way we thought they would go. Scripture says that hope deferred makes the heart grow sick. And maybe you're here and there's something that you hope for and it didn't work out. And actually, if you're honest, you haven't totally recovered from that. This morning is a wonderful opportunity for you just to look at that and say, God, this didn't work out, but you're still in control. And actually, you've got something more for me in the future. And I also want to talk to people, maybe there was a door that you hoped would open and it's closed. And it just hasn't happened once, it happened several times. Doors feel like they've closed around you. And I just want to encourage you this morning not to give up. Like what Cody was saying, that God's got something more for you in the future. And then I also wanted to talk just around security. How when things don't go well, we tend to look at ourselves and we begin to say we are the problem. This thing hasn't happened for me. Maybe it's because I'm a sinner. Maybe it's because I'm not good enough. Maybe it's because I'm not talented enough. Maybe it's because I don't have the right body shape. Maybe it's because I don't have whatever it is. And I believe that this morning is an incredible opportunity for us to be grounded in our security, not in who we are or what we can do, but in who God is and who he says we are. And so if any of those categories kind of just apply to you, I just want to encourage you this morning, as we just have a few more moments, just for you just to cry out to God and just to put your hope in him. Be anchored in him. Find your identity in him. And so let me just pray for us. And as I'm praying, I'm just inviting you to be also crying out to God in any of those areas. Yeah, Father, as we are here this morning, I know there are many of us in different situations. Maybe it could be health situations where we've tried this, we've tried that, and it's like, it's not working. Maybe it could be with work opportunities, business. I've tried this and I've tried that and it's not working. Maybe it could be relationally. I thought I would be married at this time. I thought I'd have a child at this time, but it's not working. Maybe it could be with things that we thought, yes, I'm going out, I'm sharing the gospel, I'm sharing my faith, I'm doing this great work. And it feels like it's not working. Doors are closing around me. And Lord, I just want to lift up our hearts. You're the one who knows deep in our hearts. You know where hope has been deferred and it's caused us to become discouraged, to become disillusioned, to give up, to stop moving forward. And Lord, I just want to open my own heart and I pray for each person who hears me that you would restore us to full health and full hope this morning. Would you turn our disappointment, would you turn our disillusionment and bring us to a place of fresh hope and fresh faith. And Lord, I pray for people who are in waiting and it's like, yes, exactly what Cody was saying. I'm waiting and it feels like I've been waiting for a long time. This morning, Lord, would you renew their strength. Renew strength in those who are waiting upon you. May we not just wait, but may we wait upon you. Lord, I pray for us as a nation, as we are waiting for elections, but more than that, Lord, we are looking for justice. We are looking for righteousness in leaders and in government. I pray that we would wait upon you, that our hope would not be who's announced in this position or that, but our hope would be that you are working in this nation. You are working within our leadership. You are working within our communities. You are working within our lives. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Amen. Hey, that was a lot to deal with. And if you'd like somebody just to talk to and pray with you after this, please just come forward. There'll be a few leaders present who are more than delighted to just talk to you and pray with you. And so don't feel like you have to rush off. But otherwise, we can call an end to our meeting. Please do join us for chai and mandazi. That will help us in this chilly weather. And if you are joining us for the first time and you filled out the card, please just slip it into the box so that we can get in touch with you. And remember just to go and pick up the children between the ages of 2 and 10 so that we can release our volunteers as well. But otherwise, remember, God is for you, God is with you, and you can put your hope and your trust in Him because He is trustworthy. And if you're too anxious about who's going to be announced president tonight, make sure, not tonight, when the elections are announced. Okay. When the elections are announced. No, that is not a word from the Lord. Be with somebody who will encourage you. All right, have a great week, guys, and see you next week.